Welcome. This is one of the Retrospect talks. So I'm going to talk about labs I have made. I've been a lab designer for 16 years, maybe, which means that there's a lot of labs to go through by now. So I'll just be very short about each of them. I'd also like to talk a bit about inspirations for these different works. I made a soundtrack for this, because then I will be able, hopefully, to keep the time. Yeah. Just one moment. Yes. Should be playing now. Okay. So. Okay. I'll do like this to show that we should have new slides. And I'll do that one. Okay, so one of the things I'm going to talk about is I have a master's degree in theatre performance and dance. So I'm going to talk about how to find inspiration from artistic practices. And some of the things that I really love about art is that it's an intuitive process. It's more through the body. And it's a way to explore how we perceive and how we create reality. Yeah. I try to like categorize the labs a bit, so I'm going to talk about the early stuff I made first, and then I'll move on to black box lab and freeform or tabletop labs. I called it artist collaborations, which is stuff made kind of in an art context, and the last thing is labs that include an audience. Cool. I'll do like this, and I'll get the music started. Okay, cool. My first lab was a vampire lab. It was at a school that was like 40-50 players with long written characters. I made it together with Jakob Christensen and Jakob Becker. I think it took place on Mars for some reason, but otherwise it was quite good. My first freeform game was The Prisoners of Falkenborg, which was a detective story set in the Middle Ages. It was very teenagey, a very emotional and very long and not that good. Then I made The Testament of Uncle Ebenezer, again together with Jakob Becker. It was set at a castle, so we had a great location. People were in beautiful clothes. Again, we had really long pre-written characters, and people could like go into the gamistic elements of negotiating the inheritance, or they could have like dramatic scenes, or they could just enjoy being in a castle with the beautiful clothes. And again, together with Jakob Becker, I made In the Claws of Cerberus, which took place in an underground chalk mine. We didn't tell the players in advance where this was going to take place, and we purposely didn't bring enough blankets, and the food was horrible, and people like finding their way with the small candle lights, and we stole those, so people were sitting in the darkness. But it was quite a successful experience for the time. The reunion was like high school religion lab I made together with Simon Steen Hansen. We wrote the characters for the first day of school for all these children, and then we workshopped people throughout all the different stages at school until the graduation. Then there was some time before the lab, and people figured out for themselves what was happening in these 10 years before the reunion happened. And we met, and also it was a body snatcher lab, so on top of all the being adults, pretending to be kids, we also had people like snatching other people's minds. Mini life is a concept that we ran in Copenhagen for a couple of years. We were 5-6 designers who spent an evening to design a lab together. And then we spent like an evening or a day to play it. We made 8 labs, I think, all in all. And it was a quite good concept. And I made a tribe lab once. I don't remember if it had a name even. It was the first paid assignment I ever got, and it was from a women's club who wanted to like challenge each other in different ways. Wasn't that good design, but they were happy about it. Yes. Okay, so we're going to talk a bit about something called the body-mind theory, and I'm going to take a drink of water. So the basic concept of body-mind is that we experience the world every second around us, through our bodies, through our senses, through our movement. Like when we're born, before we start to get concepts, before we start to get language, we learn how the world works by physically interacting with it. And this is still a big part of how we perceive every single second. If you close your eyes, I think you'll be able to feel like where every single part of your body are, if you like just pay attention to it. And if you try to open your eyes and just for a moment not see the objects or see me, but see all the colors and the nuances and the shapes, like there's so many impressions all the time that we're getting. Sorry. And this is a really valuable thing to design for, because we are unconsciously influenced by all these impressions all the time. And I mean, if you go in and you change the way that people move or perceive or like just make them aware that they are sensing all the time, this is a good tool to create big experiences. So, again, together with Simon Stig Hansen, I made White Death, which is a physical and non-verbal lab. So the players are getting physical characters. They play human characters first, which are restricted in a way that they can move, and they move in a heavy and hard and sudden and violent way, and are struggling because they are insecure or afraid. And then halfway through the game, they change and they become transparent ones. And those move in a light and a fragile and flowing way, and they have no movement restrictions. And the point of this lab, for me, I think, is this transformation from being restricted or being like uncomfortable in your own body, to relax and to enjoy to be with other people. And this goes through body, like it's because that people change the way that they move that they get this feeling of relief. Yeah. And also because there's no language, every single player has the opportunity to like interpret all the situations for themselves, and like make the situations meaningful, through the physical interaction. Cool. Beginning is a lab that focuses even more on senses. The players are blindfolded throughout the whole lab, and again, it's a physical and non-verbal lab. So they only have like they can like use the senses, and they can navigate through touch. It's a story about blind beings coming to life and exploring themselves and the world around them, and being guided by people who can actually see. They make characters from the images like those. Yeah, so the character creation is also quite abstract and intuitive. And because the players are blindfolded, their senses get sharpened, like they become aware of what they're actually sensing and feeling. And the lab has a very slow pace to enable players to actually, again, experiencing what they are sensing, and again, make their own interpretation and own meaning of the situations that they encounter. Strangers is a lab I made for a funeral art academy. They had a theme about integration, and they wanted to explore integration and cultural differences in a more physical way than just discussing the theme. And I really wanted to make a lab which wasn't just about how horrible it is to be a stranger in a new community, but to like take it from both sides. Also, why it can be difficult to let new people in, even though you have the best intentions. So the players are playing the green people and the blue people. They are in different parts of the room, and they workshop in different groups. They create individual sign languages, like for each group, and a routine way to go through the day. And then at some point in the lab, one group is hit by disaster, and they start to be put into the other group, where they know no one, and they don't know like the language, the sign language. It's a non-verbal lab again. And they don't know the daily routines. And this, of course, is really difficult to deal with, both for the newcomers who don't know how to behave in those situations, but also for the people who lived there before, because their routines are also broken by way too many people all of a sudden being there, and the frustration of not being able to tell people what they're doing wrong, because they don't speak the same language. Yeah, it's also a thing. So again, it's a physical way to investigate this theme. I think it works quite well because it's abstract and people like attach their own meanings to all the stuff that's going on. Innocence is a lab about clowns. Small innocence clowns who get left behind by the circus. Their longing for the circus are represented by small drawings of the circus that they make. They make important relationships to one another by holding different ends of a thread. Then an evil salesman comes and tries to get them to sell their dreams about the circus in order to get gibberish language and sell their precious relations to get freedom and like coolness. But if they do so, they miss some of the things that might be difficult but also makes them clowns. So at the end of the game, they get their noses taken away and they are led away from the other clowns who get to stay behind and experience the circus returning. So I made a lot of non-verbal labs, but I also find language to be really interesting to work with. I think that whereas we experience the world to a greatest extent through our bodies, the conscious way that we make a sense of things is to a high degree through language and through thoughts and opinions, interpretations and stuff like that. And again, this makes a very powerful tool to work with. The way that we use language, like the words that we choose, is quite personal. It's connected to who we are. Like if people don't have a big vocabulary, it's really easy to see them as being a bit more stupid. And also like different subcultures have different ways of talking. I come from an academic background, and like a lot of what we learn is to use the right words to sound academic. And in a way it's a bit silly, but it's also like when you learn a specific way of talking, you also learn that way of thinking. So being conscious about how we talk and which words we use can be a good thing. And again, it's really powerful to use and design, design for different ways of talking. And surprisingly enough, it is a lot harder to get people to talk in a new way than it is to get them to move in a new way. And I think again, it's because it's a really personal thing for us. Yeah. Also, poetic language, like, you can have language that communicates something like one-to-one, but also you can use language for the sounds or the rhythms in it. And then the language communicates on another level than just the spoken words. Okay, so I made a freeform game called End of the World. It's about the world ending. It has three main characters who are a bit lost and lonely. There's a boy who's afraid to grow up, and a woman who just had a child and have difficulty feeding into that role, and an old man who has difficulties accepting that the world is not seeing him as that the world is only perceiving him as being old. They wake up one morning and they know that the world is going to end really soon, and that they have this last day to say goodbye to everything that they know and love. In the first part of the game, the three main characters don't know each other, so the players describe each individually. They don't react to each other, they just tell one at a time. And in the second part, where they actually meet, they get to interact, you know, and there's a game master setting the scenes, and the players will react to this. And in the last part, they're sitting on the top of the mountains, where the world is ending, and the only thing that's left is their voices. So they get to say this last thing they have to say. Also, the players describe the characters in third person, and they don't have names, so they will say the boy, for example, if that's the character you're playing, and how you talk about the boy will change who the boy is. If the boy, something good is happening to him, the player will call him the happy boy or the lucky boy. So their identities change depending on what happened to them, and it's communicated through language. Alice is another freeform game. It's based on Alice in Wonderland. It has three characters. It has Alice, the main person, and then there's Dream and Reality. And Dream and Reality are both characters that have goals and personalities, but they are also worlds. And they kind of run the game. They're the ones describing the scenes to Alice. It's a bit complicated. They have cards like this to describe from. And they mirror each other, so they perceive the situations in different ways. Like this scene, from Dream's perspective, Alice is encountering a caterpillar sitting on top of a giant mushroom, whereas Reality sees it as Alice being at a police station. And in this first scene, Dream is the one with the most power. So Dream and one telling Alice what is happening. And then Reality can pitch in and give small glimpses of how it is in that world. On top of that, the two realities, Dream and Reality, have different ways of talking. Reality uses down-to-earth language and focuses on sensual impressions, whereas Dream uses metaphors and rhymes and images to describe the places that Alice encounters. Under the Rainbow is a short, freeform game about creatures who are not happy about being who they are. So they go to meet the wizard. If they find friendship on the way, they get to live happily ever after. If they don't, they become something else. They become pretty objects instead of being, being creatures. So the next theme is, I called it inspiration from art. I think a lot of the inspiration comes from that field. Art has this thing about working intuitively and often communicates more abstractly into the body. And also art has this way of playing with the way that we use language. Some art has, but I really like that about it. And also I feel art is often a combination of different abstract elements which allows the audience to make their own meaning in what they see. I'd like to give an example on this. This is an abstract painting. When you look at it, you can probably imagine what it is a painting of. Maybe. Or maybe just get a feel of the colors and the mood of the painting. It has a title. It's called Knut Descending a Staircase. And at least for me, when I know that this is the title, I start imagining where the Knut are in this picture. if there were a soundscape, if someone went that would also influence how you perceive this painting. So a lot of different elements put together, not being told how to interpret this, but by yourself making this somewhat meaningful. The next thing I'm going to go through is, call it artist collaboration, I don't know what else to call it. There's quite a lot of these, so I'm going through them quite fast. And with music. Before We Wake was a lab about dreams. We wanted to create the feeling of being inside a dream. We're quite a big group designing this together. It has some really good abstract elements, like there are different levels that the players could play on. Like the ground level was just making soundscapes together and moving together, reacting on other people. And then players could rise up from this soup of movement and sound, and they could start to interpret this together with the scenography to be dreamscapes and themselves as dreamers. And there was a third option, which was like stepping out and interpreting the dreams from outside of it, not being part, but analyzing what these dreams might mean. As part of the design process, we made three small labs. I made one of them, which was like we made the labs to explore different what's it called, tools that we were going to use in the game design. So the first test run was about exploring the like intuitively reacting to other people's sounds and movements. So the lab became about a dream creature, all the players being one big creature. And then it would split up, being individuals, and then it would become part of the world, like intuitively reacting to objects and sounds around them. The Other Life project is an ongoing project I'm making together with Peter Mundegaard. It's an exploration of identity, I think. Players don't get a character. They get their normal name and identity taken away, kind of, or leave it behind when they enter the room. And it doesn't have a fiction either. It's more a room that you enter where there's different suggestions for what you can do. But I feel what it does, like, is it gives a freedom to not being accountable for your normal perception of self, and therefore being able to react a bit more freely in whatever's going on. Inside Myself, Outside Myself was a collaborative design process that we made a couple of times. We collected, got artists and lab designers to come and to together design an audience-inclusive lab. We had a day to do this and then an evening to play. The first one, Inside Myself, Outside Myself, became a story about robots getting activated by the audience and then reacting towards the audience and then teaching the audience new things. Real Unreal was the second of these design processes. This became about Facebook profiles. That was what we played, so we could like stand up and say something and that would be a post, and people could come and stand behind us. That would be a response to that post. We played a group of friends who had these Facebook profiles, and there was a story about a missing friend in there somewhere. The audience had cameras with small lights on them. So it was interesting that they could light us and stuff like that. The room was completely dark, so it was very visible who got all the attention at which point. Checkerboard Crew is a lab I made together with Adam James. It's played outside in the city, and it's about a group of people or being something that's trying to find a place to belong. They don't have a language, but they can like physically interpret their surroundings by mimicking different objects. So you like go around the city and pretend to be a tree or a fence or whatever. Fears and Borders is a lab made together with Camilla Askholm, who was a student at Funen Art Academy, and she had a final project, an exhibition about fears and borders, and she wanted a lab to be part of this. I think what is interesting about this lab is that we took part of the exhibition and used it for the characters. The exhibition were people sitting on the bench thinking about fears and borders and then writing down their thoughts about this. Yes. The Zeigarnik effect was a piece by artist Brody Condon. It was filmed and live streamed to a nearby gallery, and I was hired in to help with the game design and the workshop design. It is an abstract therapy session using Gestalt therapy, which is very much also about going through the body and being real to what you're feeling right now. And I think what worked very well with this lab was that because there was an audience, we were trying to get players to not perform, but just be real in the situation. And this was something that the facilitator, which was an alien intelligence in the form of a big rock, could tell people, like could tell the participants in the therapy session that now they were acting and now they should be more real. The Eighth Palace is a piece I'm doing together with another artist called Cesar Alvarez. It's a mix between theater, like interactive theater and lab. So it's made for an audience who plays the lab, but because they have the expectations of going to a theater piece, we have to work quite a lot with how to manage those expectations. It's a lab about also senses and how to perceive the world through your body, and it's about beings who have yet to emerge, who are going through eighth palaces, learning to sense, like getting something to taste and something to hear, and it's quite inspired by beginning, the other sensory lab, but eighth palace is a lot, like it has a lot more coherent aesthetics, I think. We made a script for the whole workshop, played by actors. Yes. The last theme is audience, including audience inclusivity in lab. I think there's a big potential in bringing audience into lab. And I also think it is really, really hard to design for. I like bringing an audience in because I think, as a player, it has some interesting possibilities to be watched and to be like watched in a friendly way, where people are there to be part of your experience. And I think lab can be really watchable because it has this realness, and also like as lab designers, we can make people do whatever, like we can make them move or interact in interesting ways. But when you add an audience to the lab, like you're designing for two different experiences at the same time, there's both the experience of the labers and of the audiences. And if you manage to connect these, of course that's good, but often it's hard to like include the audience in a way which is both meaningful for the audience and meaningful for the lab, and which at the same time allowed the audience to either spectate or to actually be a part of what's going on. Yes. The first lab we made that was audience inclusive was at a culture night in a culture house in Copenhagen. I invited people to come and co-design this, and we drank beer during the design process, and we were kind of drunk already when the audience came. Surprisingly enough, it worked quite well. The audience felt entertained, and each time a new group of audience came, we would like escalate all the conflicts. So it became quite fun to play as well. Palau is another audience-inclusive piece that we made in Husum. It was about creatures who lived up words and that like eat them. And now their world had become empty of words, so they had to like go to the human world and collect words in different ways from people. Fragile Lives, or The Fragile Lives of Souls Gone Missing, is another piece I've made for audiences. It's about about lost souls who are alone in worlds that they are inventing through describing them. So like in order to feel that the world around them is real, They would like continuously describe what they are experiencing and describe the world around them. They can't see each other and they can't interact through touch if they like randomly run into one another. The audience have different kinds of specific ways of getting in touch with the lost souls. They can, there's been different iterations, but sometimes they wear masks and then the souls can see them, or they have objects that they can use to interact with the souls, or they can write messages for them. There's been some really good runs of the lab, and some people have had good experiences, but it's still not really stable. I think one of the reasons that the lab isn't completely working yet is that, from the lab's perspective, the theme of the lab is this, on one hand, the physical world, the touch, the things that actually are there, and on the other hand, there is the perceived realities, which is only there as long as they describe them. But the way that the audience interacts with the lab's isn't directly connected to these themes, and I think it can sometimes make them feel like extras, like they don't really belong in this fiction. Human experience is the last lab I'm going to talk about. It's also audience inclusive, and this lab is about, again, experiencing how we move and sense. It's a lab about ancient consciousnesses who have been flowing around the world forever, and they have like experienced the world from the outside, but they never had bodies, so they never been physically in touch with anything. Now they get the chance to be inside human bodies for an hour, and to get an expression of what it's like to be human and experience as humans do. The bodies that they are possessing have a limited thing that they can do. They can stand and walk and lie down and nod to people and greet them and stuff like that. But no more than that. But when they walk around, they react to one another's like these simple actions. Then there is the audience who plays humans, come in and help these ancient consciousnesses to learn new movements and to learn to sense in different ways. The consciousnesses communicate with the audience through small cards with instructions either to do movements or to describe a sensory impression. And also that the consciousnesses can't speak unless they're really experiencing something really powerful. And then they can close their eyes and they can like describe the feeling they get from a movement or from a sensory impression. So when the consciousnesses give a card to a human, with a movement for example, the human will show them this movement, and the consciousnesses are repeating the movement and then closing their eyes. And then describing what this movement feels like for them. And because the consciousnesses are reacting to one another, other consciousnesses might start to do the same. Like it has this ripple effect of people all of a sudden having this weird movements together. But it's quite quite beautiful to look at. So actually this is the only audience participatory work I've made on my own that is actually working quite well. And I think this is because the theme of the experience is the same for audiences and for participants. So both the audience and participants get this sensation of feeling into new ways of moving or experiencing. And also I think when Fragile Life has kind of a narrative, like people are telling what they experience it all the time, Fragile Life is more like dance. It has beautiful images coming up from people moving, and a lot of like small, beautiful moments. And also in Fragile Lives, the audiences are asked to be the ones initiating the interactions, which is really hard when you step into a new fiction that you don't know. Like it takes time to learn to do this. Whereas in the human experience, the initiative is from the players who actually know this fiction, and it's quite powerful to be invited in to come and be part of the experience. Yeah. That was it. Thank you so much for listening. Yeah, we have like 5 minutes for questions if you would like.
In my experience, organizing a LARP with an audience, it's very hard to get the LARPers to come because they don't want to perform their own. How do you solve that problem?
I'm still working on that. I think it's a matter of continue to just do it. I think there is a lot of qualities also, like from the LARP perspective, to find with having an audience. We just have to be able to communicate why this is a great experience for LARPers as well. Mm-hmm. That sounds cool.
Will these slides be available?
Oh, yeah, sure.
How do you develop a piece? Do you have an idea or a movement? Or like, what's your starting point?
Oh, yeah. It's very different. End of the World came from a dream, for example, that has this, like, I dreamt about the world ending and it had this really, really beautiful feel to it. So that was kind of a starting point, and then adding music and adding story was about finding this feel again. Sometimes more like an idea, but I think it's often an emotion or a sensation that's the starting point. Sorry? Yeah.
How does the process sort of differ for you when you do you bring people into a project when you have already got that idea, or do you start with in the group and say we shall make something from scratch?
I tried both, I think. Either being drawn into an existing idea, but I think often it is more a matter of finding people that you want to work with and then having that as a starting point. With César, theater piece about, yeah, I got invited to America to do a project together, and then we had some time to figure out what this should be about. Yeah.
I will ask the dull question about money. How many of these last projects did you actually get grant or funds for?
Not that many. The Zeigarnik effect was paid, but that was also because I was hired in to do a specific part of it. And when I travel, I often, like, sometimes people find other ways to pay, like, then I go and teach a class or do something else and then I get paid for that, so you, like, find ways around it. I think maybe it might be common, but it's, yeah, still really hard to get paid for this kind of stuff.
When you go to conventional LARPs, I imagine you must notice that a lot of attention is maybe not paid so much to space and movement. And what do you have, like, little pet peeves that you would try to fix, or like is there something you would recommend people add more to in conventional LARPs?
Like for the spaces that we are used to running.
Space and movement and time and language.
I think time is a big thing. For me, at least, being present in the room at least an hour before is important, like to find out how to use the space and to set up, of course. I think also, like, you develop a skill of finding materials that are easy to carry and easy to put up.
It still makes things look good.
Almost think black boxes are really good to work with. And knowing that this is a lab that should be moved around makes it easier to design for using different spaces for the lab that you're creating. Does that make sense?
Yes.
Thank you. I think if there's no more questions, we're going to wrap it up here because there's ending ceremony in like 5 minutes. Thank you so much for the time.